I hope this works. I pushed the record button.
It worked.
Did it work? I didn't see it.
Yeah. It went across my screen.
You saw it. Okay.
It's still there.
This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 400. Finally got there. Gary's 100. Top. Oh, I messed that up. Gary's top 100. 10. Top 10. No, it is a top 10. Gary's top Ham Radio Now episodes. I think we're going to be here all day. We're going to get to 100 of them.
Glad to see you screw up as much as I do.
Oh, it was a long morning. We got to get Wirecast to fix the whole shadow thing.
Shadow?
The shadow. You know, there's the shadow. You know, every time you change this, the shadow goes off.
Except
now when I try to show it to you because it didn't. I'm David Goldenberg, yep. W0DHG. And live from over there.
What I say on the new show is from the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Cary, because it's a local show. People know where Cary is. For this, it's just Gary from Cary.
Excellent.
What's going bloop bloop? Oh, you put up an image.
Well, I tried to put it said. Up. I tried to put it full screen because I could see. I could see the Skype. I can see the Skype bar in the top, and it won't go away.
Yeah, it's a new Skype. Skype keeps changing things, and you can't get a full screen anymore out of it.
Is that what it is? Okay, so I should stop trying to fix that.
Yeah, all right, it won't work. You'll see there's no full screen button anymore.
Yeah.
The usual Windows full screen thing.
Is that so everybody that knows we're using Skype to run our shows? I think that's their marketing thing.
I guess. What I've done for a long time is I've blown that screen up a little bit to get rid of all the peripheral stuff anyway.
Yeah, I'll do that later on. Well, hi, Gary.
How are you? Hi, doing? David.
Yeah, still you have you as host emeritus. And you're having fun. How's the new show going?
The new show has absolutely no audience. Well, a couple of dozen. And I'm having fun. I have a co-host. I'm not even calling her a co-host. I think co-host designates a subordinate position. I'm trying to indicate that we're at the same level.
Well, and you know, so I'm listening.
That's what she looks
or whatever.
Like.
Yeah, I'm listening or watching or whatever, and you keep calling her host. Yeah. And I always keep wondering if you just want to be TD now. Is that it? You're going to
No, it's two hosts.
Got it.
Hostage.
Right. How do I get to the top? Oh, home. There we go. Yeah, I've been enjoying it.
Her name is Julia McClung.
Uh-huh.
And she is a podcast professional. Mm-hmm. We have chemistry.
Excellent. Yeah, you guys do. It's good. Although I think the first show I saw her with, she was like somewhere in Texas. And I was trying to figure out what the triangle was. The triangle got really big all of a sudden.
She was in Utah.
Was that it? Okay.
It was remote.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. So she was like vacationing or something.
Yeah, she was volunteering at the same place that Cindy does, at the Best Friends Animal Shelter, Sanctuary, Society is what they name it as, the Best Friends Animal Society. But what they are is giant animal rescue place.
Got it. Cool.
So that's where she was, and she appeared on The Gun Show.
Yep.
I think she was at home in Durham.
Yeah, and Jeff and somebody else was on that show too.
Yeah, Jeff was on there. All familiar people from Ham Radio Now. And then a local guy who does a podcast called Triangle Tactical. And it is not necessarily triangle related. This triangle thing that we're talking about is the area that I live in is called the Triangle of North Carolina. And originally, it was Raleigh, Durham, and Chapel Hill. Well, now the town I live in, Cary, is bigger than Chapel Hill, but it would make an awkward triangle. In the center of that is something called the Research Triangle, or the Research Triangle Park, which is a tech enclave started by IBM back in 1964. Now it's got a lot of high-tech places.
Yeah, we've heard of that on the West Coast, the Research Triangle Park.
Yeah. It's a big deal. And so that's why I called it the Triangle Talk Show, even though people from out of the area, they think, first of all, are you going to talk about triangles?
Right.
Because that would seem to be kind of limited. Or the Bermuda Triangle. Mm-hmm. But no, it's local. It's somewhat political and somewhat just whatever we feel like talking about.
Yeah, there's a lot of the bull sessions so far.
Yeah, but and good. I'm up to episode 24, so I'm prolific.
Well, you're doing better than I am.
Well, I'm retired. I don't have anything else to do.
Well, I've been enjoying them. Hopefully it will continue to grow.
Hopefully. Yeah, it would be nice to get an audience.
Yeah.
If it never does. You know, I miss the, I was always whining and complaining about 1,000 to 3,000 folks watching Ham Radio Now.
Right.
And so now there's a dozen to two dozen. That's different. It's okay.
It's all right. They'll grow. You'll get more. Are you going to bring people in or?
Trying to. I've invited some folks and never gotten responses. There is a local guy. He's very well known. At least he's been very well known in political circles. He's been a Democratic consultant. The last big campaign he worked on was the governor. More than a decade ago, two decades ago, but he's still well known. His name is Gary Pierce. He spells it the same way I do.
The same, but a different Gary Pierce.
Yeah, he's not me. Definitely not me.
Got it.
We've had a little bit of crossover. He's worked with all of the big political consultants, and in my television career, I also worked with several of the people he's worked with, and I've met him once. He was giving a talk at a group, and I was invited to be there and introduced myself. He got a lot of my phone calls. I got a lot of his. Whenever some big political thing was happening in North Carolina, the big networks would call him for comment and reach me because my phone number was listed and his wasn't. So people would call up. This is NBC calling for Gary Pierce. Well, you reached the Gary Pierce, but probably not the one you want. And I was doing public relations for Ham Radio back then. This was in the 90s when I arrived in North Carolina in 1990 and hooked up with a local club. And my experience with media made me the natural guy for PR, same with the Aries group. So I was promoting Ham Radio quite a bit. And so in the newspaper, in the on the TV show, TV stations on the news, especially around field day, but also whenever a hurricane was threatening the area. There was a time when I was in everybody's Rolodex and I was the guy they called. And so he would see his name in the newspaper about this ham radio thing, and I would see my name in the newspaper about politics. And so he knew who it was.
Got it.
And so, I think where I was going with this is, as soon as I started the show, I played the Gary Pierce card and said, would you come on and be a guest? There's not going to be any audience.
Right.
Normally, you're on the big TV stations and there's a big audience. And he said he would. So we got something lined up for next Friday.
Cool. And you don't have to even really redo the lower thirds.
No, just use the same one. In fact, it'll look like...
let's see what it's going to look like.
Like this.
There you go. You leave the snowflake in?
Not for him.
Not for him.
I'll have to make one different for him. Although, from the perspective of the folks that use the snowflake as a pejorative, it would work for both of us.
Got it.
For both snowflakes.
All right. Well, as long as you don't offend him or anything, that would be good.
I will see. I'm not going to treat him with kid gloves. I'm going to be me.
All right. Well, yes. You'll always be you.
Yeah.
That's a good thing.
The other nice thing about the Triangle Talk Show is we swear.
Yeah, I've heard.
I push the explicit button.
Yeah, I've heard. Although there was an episode I listened to last week or the week before where it came up and you said you weren't going to push the explicit button because it wasn't as obscene as one thought. But then I think you weren't sure. I don't remember what it was even. Not something I'll say here.
Yeah. Well, YouTube doesn't require it. And the Apple, I don't know that anyone would ever do anything about it. But it's an option on the stuff I send to iTunes. So
Right.
If we've dropped the F-bomb, I'll push the explicit button. That just, all that does is make the kids want to listen.
That's exactly right. It drives them to you.
Still.
It'll keep you out of trouble with Edna Kravitz if she's watching.
Yeah. It was the case back when I was a kid in the 60s, and it's still the case now.
Yeah. That's how it's going to go. Well, so have you made any studio upgrades in order to do the new show, or downgrades, or it's all about the same?
No, I think it's about the same. As you can see, the Ham Radio Now sign is missing from the background.
I saw that.
Just put a picture of Cindy and me back there.
Right. With the second roaming gnome.
Yeah, that's a segue into the care package that I'm preparing for you.
Care package?
Yeah, sitting down here. There's
a box.
It's a box.
With a pink label on it. Does that mean there's like explosives?
I don't know. It's a used leftover box from something.
By your right hand there's like a pink label.
Dear Sony customers, in order to provide you with outstanding service, we suggest the following.
Save your box.
Don't buy anything from Sony anymore. Actually, Sony's fine. Sony's, all the cameras that are around here are Sony. By the way, there's two empty spaces I had set up for Jeff AC4ZO and Cindy KD4ECW, my wife.
Yep.
And neither one of them will be here. So
that's all right. I did a lower third for Jeff just in case. I didn't know that Cindy was a possibility.
Yeah. So here in the box is the Ham Radio Now.
Cool.
Light up sign. And the remote control for it.
Wow.
And power supply. Okay, there's the power supply.
Okay.
You can make it any color you want, although I found the green worked the best.
Okay.
And
it looks like rainbows there, huh?
Yeah, so that will be... Yeah, most of the guys... This was done by Jim's Engraving.
Okay.
And everybody who's anybody in the ham radio podcasting and YouTube business has those. All the guys on Ham Nation have one. And most of them have them flash and blink, and it sends you into an epileptic seizure while they're on the air.
I think I'll go solid colors. We'll have to play the lights to get them right.
I've got two mic flags for you.
Cool. Will those fit? Will those fit the big fat one? Well, actually, I have some Shure mics now.
These will fit on the...
They'll
fit on the ATR 2100.
Okay, cool.
It's a little fat for them, but this is very...
It's like foam in there.
Spongy foam.
All right.
Yeah. So there's two.
Excellent.
And I originally started with four, but I have repurposed two of them.
Oh. You just stickered those up?
I peeled the Ham Radio Now off and stuck that on at the Triangle Talk Show.
Yep.
And it turns out that was probably not a great idea, because the the Ham Radio Now one was very plastic or something. It was a very heavy duty, and this is just a paper label.
Got it.
Ish.
They peeling?
They aren't yet.
Yeah, you could tape over it.
But I don't expect them to be.
Take them to your CVS and ask the pharmacist to tape over them with the prescription tape.
I think what I'll do is eventually just go back to these guys and have a couple more made.
Yeah.
For Triangle Talk Show.
Is it the same guy that does the badges, or somebody else that did those?
No, this is a custom. He probably does lots of other stuff, but what I went there for was specifically for the mic flags.
Cool.
They were $10 a piece, so that's not super expensive. It was a little disappointing that it was a stick on and not actually printed on the plastic, because it's getting a little dirty around the edges.
Mm-hmm. You can't tell from here.
You can't. Let's see.
You still can't tell from here. Oh, yeah, I can see a little bit. Now you get that close up.
Yeah, just a little bit. But then I was watching on TV, the TV news people out in the field, and their microphones are all beat to crap.
Yeah.
And their mic flags are falling apart.
Yeah. I don't know. I did a remote show somewhere with somebody, and one of my Shure mics came back with a big, huge dent in it. But I have the little dead cat foam thing on it, so you can't really tell. But I took it off to clean it, and it was a big hole. It still works okay.
Okay, and then inside there are a pile of Ham Radio Now shirts.
Cool.
Freshly laundered a couple of years ago.
Thank you, thank you. Well, I'm looking forward to it.
I'm not going to give you this one.
Okay. Yeah, well, you should keep some for yourself.
I think there's one still hanging up in the closet downstairs. So there's a variety of sizes, some small, medium, and extra large.
Good, extra large will work. Gwen will fit in a medium. I don't think there's anybody who's small here anymore.
Never know.
Yep, you never know.
All right, so sweet. That's the care package will be coming to you. Probably I'll toss it on the back of a pickup truck heading west on I-40.
Excellent. Well, I'll keep
get their license number and hope they go all the way to California.
Hope they make
it. You might have to go to Barstow.
Okay, we go to Barstow. We go occasionally. We're talking about a scout trip there. I made a couple upgrades in the studio here. Let's see if I can actually show you. I don't know. Let's see if I can make this work without pulling this whole thing apart. Whoa.
Have you made your DMR radio work yet? I saw the episode.
I did. In fact, the Zoom spot's there. It's not plugged in. I need to get a fan and a case, although I may just get the fan and not the case, or I may make the fan into the case. And there's the DMR radio, and that's all working good. And then Darren's, who's been on a couple shows with me, is a sound engineer, does recording, concert, and whatever. And we were listening to the hiss that came out of the mixer, and he said,
that was pretty bad for a couple episodes.
Yeah, it was. And we traced it back to the sound card in the PC. And everything is awesome with the PC except for that. So we said, you can go out and get one of these. There you go. This Euphoria Behringer. It's another Behringer product. And it's, it's made for a mic and a guitar kind of recording single thing. But it's a sound card, separate sound card. And now the audio from the PC all goes through this. Instead of through the PC where the fans and the humming and all the power supply and all the other stuff is. And so it seems a lot better. And that was
I'm sure the audience wants to know the intricacies of Wirecast and audio, but you shouldn't have had any analog audio going through a PC sound card anyway. It should have gone USB into your PC.
I don't remember why we did that. There was something about it, but it was what we took away was on my mixer, and I think this was what we set up, right? So on the mixer, this is the, my 7 and 8, and I think we mirrored what you had, or maybe not. My 7 and 8 was the PC sound, and then the 5 and 6 was the Skype sound. And so any of the PC sound that came back from like a YouTube video or I don't know what else. Focus. that's where the hiss was when we played through each one of the channels, and that's where we found it. So we just pulled it out.
That makes sense.
Pulled it out and put it in there, and it separated out, and now we're good. And he also helped me balance everything out. In fact, he's in the chat room and wanted to know about your Super 55 mic in the background. But anyhow, I think he's talking about the one next to the gnome.
Oh yeah.
I don't know.
Okay.
Look, a squirrel.
By the way, you have a solo shot up by now.
Oh, yeah, I do.
Right now.
There's yours.
There
it
is.
It's the one back here. Is it the one next to the gnome? So it's obviously, I think it's the other side. That one. That one? That one. Is it that one, Darren? I think it's that one.
Yeah.
Yep.
Could be that one.
Yeah. I can't see that one.
I don't know. I don't know what their numbers are. I don't care.
I think the only one I can see in the shot is the fin one, the ones that Heil's reproducing now.
Okay. Yeah, that's a Shure something.
Something.
It's inherited from my brothers who are both in broadcast. And I don't really remember where I got it, but it seemed like a cool prop.
It's a prop. That's kind of what I thought. Just like the one above it with the
hand mic with the Motorola dispatcher.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they're all...
It's all props.
They worked at one point. I tried the plug in the Shure in and listening to it, and the sound was a little thin, and it had a kind of a bad hum, so...
Yeah.
I'm not going to be using this.
It's good for a prop. And you're on the Heil one prop. Now. You're on the Heil one now, right? The nice expensive
yes,
fancy.
Yes, speaking to the Heil mic.
And it sounds good.
Of course.
And it sounds good. Well, let's get on to the show. What we're here to talk about today. You sent me a list, and I thought this was great. And actually, I tried to start to do my top 10, but life got in the way. So should we count them down or we should count them up? I guess we should count them down.
Count them down, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the number one, no one is going to know. No one's going to guess.
Yes, that makes good sense.
In my estimation, was the number one show. And not necessarily the best show. Just the one that I thought just kind of deserved a showcase. Mm-hmm.
And I guessed it wrong because I thought the one that was going to be your number one when I started reading it was the one that ended up. Where was that one? Which number did that end up being? Nah, we'll get there. We'll come across it. Okay, let's see if I can actually make this work. So I'm going to pull them up in order. Right over your face, apparently. I was planning to do it over here. Let's see if I can make this work.
Which is off screen entirely.
Yep. Intentionally. Because I should do this.
Well, you can switch it.
I can't. Well.
You push the wrong button just like me.
I can. Yeah. Well, that's why I'm figuring out this whole switch thing. Because the monitors are lined up in the wrong order. So now, from left to right, I have. And it's not doing anything now. No. Now they're right to left. From right to left, I have my Dell monitor. There's Gary. And then I got the middle one, which is, yep, there. Never mind. Anyhow, so we'll start with top number 10. Number 10.
10.
That's the one.
The Dipole episode.
The Dipole episode. Episode number 82. And there's Jeff. Let's play a little Jeff. See if we can actually hear him.
Without hiss?
Without hiss. You can't hear him at all. What's happening, people?
I don't know if it's making it on the air. It's not making it to me.
It's not making it anywhere. It's amazing but true. Let's see. Is it all turned off here?
And so much for your Behringer audio connection.
Interesting. Let's see. It's funny because I can't even hear it in my ears, which means I wonder if it's not even playing at all. It's got to be playing. Well, here, while I'm trying to troubleshoot this, why don't you talk about this episode?
In episode 82. People watching Ham Radio Now may know that we... Oh, now there was a spectacular special effect.
That's what this one was going
to
be.
Yeah, I think so.
And to make it officially...
I found it. So sorry, in episode 82, go ahead and keep talking. I'll pause him. I'll turn him way down.
But that's not the Dipole episode.
Oh, did I click on the wrong?
You've gone to a different episode.
Is it?
That's a Field Day episode.
Oh, what'd I do? You're showing the Dipole. You're showing the Field Day episode.
In the middle of the Dipole episode.
Right.
I forget how clever I am.
And do you do the clap thing often? I should do the clap thing every once in a while.
When I remember if I'm doing multi-camera.
So is this portable at Jeff's place?
Yeah, this is his laboratory, his workshop.
I'm jealous because that looks like real simulated granite countertop.
That would be a good name for a show. You've wanted to do technical shows.
Yeah, but you don't want to do them because they're too much work.
It's not that I don't want to do them. It's just there's so many other things going on.
Yeah, so that's the point. We didn't do very many technical shows, any how-tos or...
We're going to do a highly technical show today.
Right. And this was one of the few, right? One of the very few. And you still, 5 years later, you still
popular.
Yeah, 5 years later, you still didn't want to do it. We kind of did a technical one with the Zoom spot thing.
Yeah, and you are welcome to do whatever you want. Yep. 33,456 views, so
yeah.
Apparently it was something worth doing. Now, making a Dipole is not hard, but it's something every new ham needs to learn how to do on HF. They're going to do HF.
That's a good angle.
I don't know why we went to a previous Field Day episode, but apparently we did. And episode 14.
Except for one. You guys were talking about the technical stuff on the show in the beginning there.
Yeah.
Well, that's great. And so this was a shorter show. It's only an hour long. But we can get
because it was all edited.
We can get into some other. I guess that's a good point. We can get into some highlights here. Bob taught in Ham Nation last week. Talked you through doing all this, but I don't think he was doing
it. One of the reasons why I think that we did this is because I'd seen Bob try to do a show on making a dipole, and he just bollocked it up.
I don't know. After the last one, he was 33 feet of wire on each side, and make your 40 meter. I was going to go out to Home Depot on the way home.
Yeah, one of the things that Bob emphasizes, and something that we totally disagree on, is that he says you should make your antennas resonant and feed them with coax. Mm-hmm. And I don't disagree with that. If you've got the room and the wherewithal to put up a dipole for every band that you want to have a dipole for, they'll work better if you make them resonant and feed them with coax.
Right.
But if you've got room for one or two and you want to work all bands, make it as long as you can and feed it with twin lead and run a tuner.
Right.
I don't know what Bob's got against tuners. I remember when I was a young ham, a little pup at my mentor's knee, and my mentor was like 2 years older than I was. I remember having a bias against tuners, not for any reason that I understood technically, because I didn't. But that seemed to be, I was getting it from osmosis or QST or somewhere, but the idea was you didn't want to run a tuner. It took a long time for me to realize that I absolutely did want to run a tuner, and I wanted to feed something with twin lead, feed a dipole with twin lead. And I put out a DVD. It's now available as a YouTube show on Ham Radio Now called Standing Up for Standing Waves. And I think I understood the concept before I did that show, which was not, I just recorded it. It was a guy giving an expert presentation about standing waves. I think I understood the concepts, but he certainly solidified my understanding of the idea that the twin lead is very low loss. And so while the signal goes up the twin lead, reaches the dipole, everything is non-resonant, it radiates some. And then when it doesn't radiate, it bounces back down the twin lead. Now, if you're running coax, every time it does that, it's going to have some loss. Mm-hmm. Going down twin lead, it's going to have some loss, but much, much, much less loss than coax. So it's signal, some radiates, some bounces back toward your transmitter or your tuner. When it gets to the tuner doesn't want it. It's also a bad match to that signal. So it bounces the signal back to the antenna where some of it's radiated and some of it bounces back. And eventually, most of it gets radiated because there's so little loss in the twin lead that it never gets used up as heat in the twin lead. It doesn't get used up as heat in the tuner. And eventually gets radiated. The pattern is not great on an antenna like that. It doesn't look like the dipole, donut pattern anymore. It's kind of random. But it gets you on the air on all bands reasonably efficiently. You'll make contacts. You won't win contests.
Right. So some,
unless you're Marty.
Some of the bands will be better than others. But just based on how well you can tune them in and how long your wire is, right?
Yeah. And surprisingly, the internal tuner in my ICOM 756 would allow me to tune many bands that I wouldn't expect to. Or that they say that it's good for SWR of about 3-1. When you're running 100 watts, it's good for more like 5-1 or 6-1. And there were a few bands that it wouldn't work on, but many bands that it was fine on 10 and 12 and 15 and 17, and I think it didn't work so well on 40. And this was with a dipole that it was about 140 feet long. So it was fine on 80, fine on 60. No, on 60 I needed the tuner, and on 40 I needed the tuner. And on 20, it was a little iffy. It's happier with the external manual tuner.
With the manual tuner, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm thinking about My father-in-law runs one of the LDG tuners, a wide range tuner. But it's still automatic.
Yeah, but those aren't as, you know, I have one of those for my Alinko HF radio, and they're way less forgiving. And they tell you right in the book that it needs to be in better shape than it would be for a manual tuner. Because a lot of times when I try to tune that up, like I have a G5 RV, and I try to tune it up on certain bands, and it comes back with an error message about half the time.
Might be a different model, because the one we got for him, I think it's the model 100 or 200 or something like that.
Works pretty good.
He's got a 90-foot dipole fed with twin lead, and it tunes every band, 10 through 100, 10 through 80, even though it's pretty short for 80. Still tunes it fine. And most of them are 1.5 to 1 or below, but if it's 2 to 1, that's fine. You won't. I'm the only ham that you'll find that will tell you that an SWR of 2 to 1 is fine, but it's fine.
Yeah.
At the receive end,
you get on the
other. If the other guy listening to you, the difference between 1.2 to 1 and 2 to 1 is not going to register on his S meter.
He's not
going to
know.
And now you may ask me why I don't do technical shows.
Yeah. So why do you do technical shows? So where did this antenna?
I don't enjoy them.
Where did this antenna end up?
It ended up over Jeff's house until it blew down.
Until it blew down.
So we need to get... All right. Chris Bloxham is watching. David Bodman is watching.
Excellent. Okay, well, so this was...
Daniel Roy is watching.
Number 10. Let's see if I can gracefully slide back to the list. Actually, I'm going to go back to us so I don't reveal all.
Yeah. And that that show is evergreen. You know, technology hasn't changed yet.
Yeah, for the making that antenna, anybody could go do that. You just have to find the parts.
Yeah, and we go through all of it. That's why it's an hour. You know, normally you know building a dipole could be done in 10 minutes or so, but we go through figuring out how to do a support line. We do our support lines out of weed eater line, not Dacron rope.
Mm-hmm. When you did that episode for the hour of content, how many hours do you think it took you to put it all together? Because I know that's the where and why you don't do those technical shows.
Yeah. Well, that was editing. I don't do any shows almost that take editing, and it probably was 2 days, two solid 8-hour days of editing.
Of editing, yeah, which is why you don't do that. All right, here goes, episode number 9.
Amadeo Unplugged, episode number 288. So fairly recent.
Yeah, pretty recent.
Aw. There's one of that's Saradine. That's the peanut as a kitten. It's a new cat.
And you know what? I listened to this one. I didn't watch this one. So I think I was sitting with my dad in the hospital when he had his heart attack.
Yeah.
When this one came out.
So at this point, they were in season 5 of Last Man Standing. John Amadeo, of course, NN6JA. The executive, one of the executive producers of Last Man Standing. And that was season 5. And the big deal about that was you get to season 5 and you get to syndication. And the program will then appear on other shows, other TV stations as a strip syndication. Around here, they were running it every night at 10 o'clock on one of the TV channels. And of course, John has been a producer for that since its beginning, executive producer. He incorporated ham radio in it. He's been on everybody's show. He's been on everybody's show talking about doing it. So we talked about how he incorporated ham radio into that program to some extent. But we went in much greater depth, and it's a very long show. I think it's, almost 2.5 hours?
Yeah.
We went into
almost 3.
Yeah, into depth on just what it takes to produce a half-hour comedy show on a major network. All the background stuff, the writing, a lot of his career and history. And he was very generous, especially since our relationship did not begin on a very pleasant note. it actually began, or not my relationship with him, but with the show began.
Relationship did not begin.
Oh wait, hold on.
Don't turn that audio on.
No, I turned that wrong one on. There it is. Sorry.
So our, I mean, you can bring him up for a second if you want.
Yeah. So here's John and Gary.
Dead in the middle of the sixth season.
You are available for 5 seasons on Netflix and a bunch of the others. But if anybody's got Netflix, they can watch the first 5 seasons.
And we're now nationally syndicated. So it's a little bit like the I Love Lucy scenario where it's just on somewhere, everywhere in the country.
Yeah. And the great part about this show was like it was just a brag chew that just the two of you guys got together and just went through it all, you know, where you've been, where you're going, and how it's going. And then they were in their prime at this point, right? 5 years?
Yeah.
Before they were canceled. They were now they're
canceled at the end of season 6.
Yep. Yep.
And by ABC, and then picked up by Fox.
Yep.
When a couple things happened, and no one at Fox, and John is not saying what really happened, but I can tell you what is speculation in the background is 2 things. One is that the audience complained because it's one of the few programs that featured any kind of conservative political stance.
Right.
And that wasn't the purpose of the show, of course. It wasn't, you know, Rush Limbaugh TV. It's just that Tim Allen's character, Mike Baxter, was conservative, and he would do, in conversations at home, his position, he would do a little video blog from the store that, you know, showed curmudgeonly political positions. I'm not sure what they would do today, and we'll see when the show comes back.
Yeah, we're going to find
out
in
September.
We'll find out pretty soon.
Yeah, what they're going to do. Although I've read in the the trades, probably in general media, that they're not going to address the Trump situation. Mm-hmm. That's probably too hot a firecracker.
Probably off the table. Yeah.
So, but he'll still be conservative. So the audience was complaining that they took the show off the air because it was conservative. And everybody said, no, that's not the reason. In terms of the audience, it was in the 7 million or so. That is sustainable for a primetime show, but it is on the edge of sustainable. You get much below that and you go off. And so if a network thinks that they've got a show that will bring in more, they might go with that show. But who knows? It could have been, you know, some snowflake at ABC that put his fist down and said, no, we will not have this on our... I don't see why they wouldn't have that on their air. No reason. In any case, Fox decided to pick it up. The other thing that the punditry out there is considering is that the popularity of Roseanne Barr show, when it came on with even stronger right-wing slant, that it had breakthrough ratings, stronger ratings than any primetime show has had in a long time. Those ratings didn't hold up over the season, but it stayed strong. And so Fox looked at that and said, we might get a similar audience bump from that publicity and that crowd at this point with a program that has similar, or at least in that direction, that vector, a political inclination. I didn't actually watch any of the Roseanne shows, so I don't know how far they went.
Yeah, I don't. We don't watch a lot of TV around here, so I didn't get it either. Well, we'll see.
Yeah, in any case, it's coming back on Fox. Yeah. They're starting to shoot. They're firing up the ham station again. So listen on. If you watch their Facebook page, you'll see when they are going to have the ham station on the air.
Yeah, and they do some local stuff, and then they do some HF stuff as well. I can work them UHF, VHF when they're on the air.
Oh, cool.
So I've done it. I got a couple of their QSL cards around.
And yeah,
got some friends. Well, actually, one of my first Elmers went and actually did a bunch of the testing for John and got all the, they were the ones that got the staff started on getting their licenses and what have you, the Goodkins.
And one of the things that John and I talk about for a while on that episode is the idea of how to incorporate ham radio in a program like that. Because, right. of course, all the hams wanted episodes that were basically the license manual.
Right. Or to and, be heavily focused around, you know, that being a major plot point. And they did actually have one show.
Two.
Yeah,
two. Well, one two. Where it was a what they call the B plot.
Yeah.
And one where it was an element for a few minutes. Mm-hmm. Thanksgiving show was the element. Mm-hmm. And I think it was the Punch or something was the show where it was the B plot. But a big B plot. It was, you know, yep. they got a lot of airtime.
Yep. Yep. And I think you rolled a little bit of that somewhere along the way.
I rolled a lot of that.
I don't remember if it was in this one or a different one.
Yeah. Well, we did two episodes. Kind of back to back, the last ham standing, and that earned a
got a takedown,
and I got some two way with John at that point, an email, and he was offering a license to use the footage. And I looked it over, and it wasn't going to work for a variety of reasons. They wanted me to use too little. And this wasn't strictly John's language. This was just boilerplate from the network.
From the studios, yeah.
They wanted me to use too little and with a time limit. And if you put something on YouTube, it's going to stay forever. So it wasn't designed for a streaming show that stays on YouTube forever.
It was for like a news clip here or there or something like that.
Yeah. So I was discussing it with John, but fighting it through YouTube's official channels. And about the middle of the discussion with John, when I was saying, no, that won't do. I think I'm just going to take my chances. Fox, the producer, it was an ABC show, but it was produced by Fox. And they just basically said, okay, your arguments are on fair use or persuasive. You can keep using it. Or in the language I got back from YouTube, the producer has declined to continue to right. to object.
Well, and it's not like any of the stuff that you've used, you haven't really blasted anybody that hard in that realm, except for maybe that one NCSI episode.
Yeah, well, I didn't have much bad to say about yeah. the last ham standing episode. It was just the amount that I used was there, you know, could be an issue.
Yeah, got it.
But I think I even made a version of the episode that had less. I think I might have used like 5 or 6 minutes, and I cut it down to 3 or 4. Yeah. But turns out I didn't need to.
Didn't matter.
Yeah, you know, they went back and said, "Yeah, we don't." Turns out we don't care.
That's one of the shows that goes on my DVR, and I'll watch every once in a while, mostly for the ham tie-in. So we'll see how it goes when they're in the reboot. I'll have to make sure the DVR is up to date for the right channels.
Yeah, well, I'll hope that there'll be another ham radio centric show, but
they've been posting pictures. I think they upgraded the rig to a 7610, the new Icon, and a flagship radio, and a whole bunch of other stuff. So I'll assume that they've invested enough in that, or Icon's invested enough in the show that they'll have it as part of the plot line.
You like think so? Set it a think B, that would make it
in a B, I guess. Well, who knows?
Yeah, because I don't expect Mike Baxter to turn to I forget what the boss there is, I forget what his name is. I just upgraded to a 7610.
So. Yeah, all right. I mean, you're right.
Theoretically, they've all got ham licenses. They were all talking to each other
yep.
in that one episode.
Yep.
So it would, I mean, they could do it.
Yeah.
They're not going to do that.
No, they probably won't. All right, we'll move on to episode number 8. I made the top 8. Episode number 8, or your number 8 was Ham Radio Now 359, Force of 22, or Force of 2.
Force of 2. Right. Force of 2.
Yep, Force of 2. Which
you have not managed to put the picture up yet.
I'm trying to find the screen. Nope. Was it this one? Oh, there it is.
Okay.
And that was the old days when I had the not as good a camera going, or maybe not as good a bandwidth or something.
looks good to me.
Does it look good? Here it doesn't look. And the what I'm looking at on the YouTube isn't as good. On my side, your side looks good. You can't see any of the wrinkles on my face. Here we talked to Jeremy and what was the other guy's name? Mike. About their experience going to
Puerto Rico.
Puerto Rico and going, what do they call it? They went Broken Arrow.
Broken Arrow?
Yeah, I remember there was the whole, you know, Jeremy went off to that island and they called him back and there was a whole bit in that towards the end of that episode where
things got dicey.
Talked to him about him going rogue and what have you. But that was a good episode. I enjoyed that. And there was a little bit of that was kind of one of my first like really doing the big research on the episode and I think both of us were concerned when we found that posting from Reddit that Jeremy had done and weren't quite clear on whether he was, you know, on the up and up or, you know, coming out from left field or what. And I talked to him on the phone a couple times and I was convinced, you know, he was the real deal and we had to bring him on to talk about his story.
Yeah. Yeah. I think we were convinced he might have embellished his story some, but you know, it's still hard to tell, but, no one has successfully claimed that he didn't do it. Jim Vanneman wants me to go on the road again in Europe or Canada. Jim, I would be happy to do that.
Somebody's got to sponsor you, right?
Cut me a check for about $10,000.
You go on vacation. Well, you got to take Cindy on a vacation. And, you know, because your travel logs are almost as good as the Ham Radio Show. It's been a big draw. But anyways, we talked to these guys for 2.5 hours. And I think
another good long episode. Show and full of really useful content.
Yep. And there was some good, you know, like we got into the, see, I got some maps here. You know, we drew into this is where they were and on the ground and, you know, gave it credibility and it gave it some context about, you know, what they really did.
Yeah. And it was not all ARRL bashing.
No, not at all.
At all. But there was enough of that in there. I expected this episode to make a bigger splash than it did. I expected it to get picked up and talked about fairly widely and was fairly disappointed that it wasn't. I don't see the view count.
Let's see,
there.
Actually, I was going to have to back off to see that. Here. So 4,500 views. So,
yeah. That's an episode that should have caught 10 to 20,000 views.
Yeah.
Based on its content. Mm-hmm. Now, you wouldn't get 10 to 20,000 people watching it for 2.5 hours.
Right. They would have started it and seen a little bit, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if ham radio were media savvy at all, and it is not, people would have excerpted pieces of that, picked up things that caught their particular attention and played it on other shows for a minute or two. And ham radio is stuck in the 1950s in terms of media, you all. And that's why I'm not doing this show anymore.
Yeah.
Because you don't get it.
Yeah. You're talking
good
about,
luck, David.
You're talking to me. You know, you're talking. No, you're, I no, know. You're now. You're talking to.
You're the, willing to keep trying.
You're talking to the audience. Well,
I tried as long as I wanted, and said it's not good enough for me. It's easily good enough for anyone who wants to do this as a hobby. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to do it as a business, and now the other show I'm going to do, I'm willing to do as a hobby.
Mm-hmm. You got the time.
Yeah. I don't have time for doing both. So. Yeah,
I get it, and I'm struggling a little bit with the time, but. You know, I'm getting 2 out a month. I would hope to be doing 3 or 4, and you know, we get what we can.
Yeah. Well, you've also done some field stuff, and you've discovered that the prep for that is much more extensive than just hooking somebody up on Skype and yakking at them for.
Well, and I'm learning all sorts of lessons because I was hoping to do a whole big AC-100 lesson, and I ran out of the house with half of my batteries and half of my memory cards and. And forgetting that, you know, being in charge of a stage means that you got to pay attention to the stage. And every once in a while, I'm like, oh, yeah, there's that video thing I'm supposed to be doing. And,
Yeah.
It was hard.
Yeah, I've always said that the PR guy in any Aries activity is a full-time job.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be done part-time by the guy who's also trying to keep things going on the air.
Yes, I'm learning that lesson.
Now, it doesn't hurt at all if you have done on the air and maybe can do that some of the shift, yeah. But dealing with the media and everybody else is full-time.
Yeah. Well, and that
every Aries group should have a full-time PIO.
Yeah, and I think we'll get there with our group as well. But you know, there was the one point where I realized, it's slow. I did my shifts, everything's going well. I get people on all the radios. Okay, let me go grab the camera and do it. And you know, it was dead battery. Yep. I was like, come on, you got to be kidding. And we thought, we'll roll back to do it on our phones. And by that time, it was late. I was like, I know the phones wouldn't have been as good in the dark, and we just kind of left it alone.
The other thing that I'll say about being the full-time PIO is expect pushback, and not least of which will be from your EC. That really depends on your EC. If you've got an EC or a DEC or a section manager who is very PR forward, then your skids will be greased. But I had an EC who thought I was subversive and had no interest in what I was doing or helping it out. And not interested in pushing it forward at all. Now, when I first started, I had a section manager who was very interested. He thought that PR was great. I won the BeGAN Award, the second one they gave away. That's for the public information officer, and got a lot of stuff in QST and on TV. And then less interest. Current section manager, is a friend of mine, Carl. He's been on the show, and he would be PR forward. But I gave up the PR stuff a long time ago because not enough time.
Yeah, I don't think we have a PR person, and I'm the EC. But
is there a PIC for the
division?
At the section
at the section level, but it's not somebody that would roll into anything that we're doing. But I know, I get support from the DEC on all this. It's just a matter of making sure all the other stuff is covered.
Yeah. In California, your sections are about 4-8 square blocks or so.
For some of them, there are. We know Los Angeles is a section. But, it's a lot of people. It's, as many people in that section as a lot of the other sections that cover entire states.
Yeah. And North Carolina is a one section state. Yeah. In terms of population, there's about 20,000 hams. And so probably about right. The only reason it ought to be two sections is because it's 500 miles wide.
Yeah.
And the folks in the western part don't see a section manager who lives in the eastern part very often, or vice versa. There hasn't been a section manager from the western part because those aren't the population centers. Uh-huh. But there could be a reason why not.
Yeah. All right, moving on. And I've got this one queued up. Let me see if I can get this right. Boom.
It's going to be a lot of practice at this.
Woohoo! That's right. Get to number 7, Ham Radio Now visits the Hawaiian Beacon. And look.
Put up the sound.
You got the lovely Cindy there.
Over California as soon as it hit the ocean, and who knows where it is, we may never see it again. But we are out here in Hawaii. No one's buying that. I'm going to be editing this thing on a laptop computer, and I was in a hurry getting out of town, and I didn't bring all the graphics. So no flying logo from this end. You'll see it again, don't worry. Oh, wait a minute. We do have a bigger problem, though.
What?
We'll look at this. Step out of the picture for a second.
Yeah.
Isn't that beautiful? You know, this program is financially supported by viewers' contributions. And when they see where we are and what they think we're doing with their money, we're not going to make another dime off of this. We need something a little less enticing, a little bit more unforgiving.
Inhospitable.
See if we can find a better place to do this. Not here.
Nope, not here. No, not here. Go away.
Yeah, 73 KN4AQ portable KH6 over and out. We're not here.
Maybe. Nah. Oh, yeah, that's it.
No, it's not.
Oh, yeah. This is desolation. No one's going to want to come here. Welcome to lush tropical moon.
Yes, lava-ridden.
Okay, I think you're... But it's you can drop out that audio. But that's,
you guys had fun with that.
Now, that was production.
Yep.
That was network quality production.
Yep. Oh, and there you are. You're in the closed area? No, you're next to the closed area.
Well, all of it was open on that trip anyway. But we were in Kilauea Iki at that point. And that was just a little bit of introduction. The main purpose of this episode was to go up on, not the top of Mauna Loa, because it's not, the beacon is not at the top. It's at the 8,000 foot level. Mm-hmm. And take a look at the beacon. This was the KH6HME VHF UHF beacon that Paul Lieb built. And this happened the year after Paul Lieb died. So I got a tour from Fred, I think Fred Honnold was his name, who was maintaining it at the time. Now he's left the island, but it's still being maintained by their people. We were out there earlier this year. It had changed frequency. At first I thought it was off the air because I tuned in the frequencies that it was on when I did the show because I had them in my handy talkie. And there was nothing. And I thought, oh my God, the beacon's off the air. But then I tuned around and found it. So.
And it's just those still two on the air. Just those two little there's 2 meter Yagis up on the top.
It's I guess the stack 2 meter Yagis for 2 meters, but there are antennas for 70 centimeters and 2.4 gig, or maybe 1.2 gig.
There's another stack next to it.
Don't know if there's a 6 meter.
Yeah.
So
there you go.
Yeah. So there's they got quite a bunch.
Cool. We'll have to catch up on this episode. I've not seen that one.
Yeah, I think you know a lot of people know about the beacon, but very few people had seen the beacon.
Uh-huh.
So there it is.
There's a good episode. Now the next one was one of my favorites, and one I was super jealous and wasn't able to join you for. You sat down with some real famous folks,
Jerry Ellsworth and Amy Hendren.
Yep.
And right now, I can't remember either call sign. Because there's no way
to prove it. Yeah.
But it's pretty good.
Let's see. Jerry is AI6TK, and Amy is KM6FZE, but she may have changed it. Can't remember or not. She was talking about vanity call.
So this is a Tapper conference in, was it in Austin? Or Atlanta?
Let's see.
See if I say.
Doesn't say there. Oh, Tapper DCC. 2017 Tapper.
Yeah.
And this one got almost might have been 7,500 views.
Well, it's because Jerry's famous.
Yes, yes. Oh, this is Daytona.
Oh,
we spotted her at Daytona Hamvention. Oh, no, this was Tapper, but you spotted her there. I don't know what that meant.
I saw her at Dayton that year. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't sure it was her, and I didn't want to go like stalking and running down the hall.
Right, you don't want to seem like a fanboy.
Yeah.
Oh, you're talking about that here.
And your call is AI6 what?
AI6TK.
Okay, and you couldn't get AR6 because it's not within.
I know.
You wanted it all.
You know, interesting thing during the beginning of that interview, I was trying to remember the name augmented reality. And those two words would not
couldn't get it out
hit my brain.
I don't know.
Because Jerry's primary claim to fame, at least at that point, was for the company that she had had founded, building an augmented reality headset. And she had basically lost that company. She lost the financing and had to close that company.
I'm going for my extra.
All right, excellent.
Yep.
And then she was able to form a new company. And at that point, she was telling me about it, but we couldn't talk about it because hadn't closed the deal and didn't for a while longer.
Right.
Basically buying out the assets of the previous company and starting a new one. So she's still working on developing an augmented reality headset.
Yeah. This was such an interesting one too, because it's a great interview, and you just did it in the looks like in the middle of the hallway somewhere.
Yeah, you right know? Outside the room at the end of a hallway, plop as down. People were packing up and heading out, and
grab a couple chairs, and we're just gonna do it right here.
Yeah, well, had to do it fast. Had to set up fast. You know, I'd just torn down from shooting the DCC, and had to get everything ready, and then. Dead tired.
Yeah.
We all were. But
yeah.
And I'm just standing up behind the camera for 2.5 days.
Yeah. And those have got to be big, long, long weekends yeah. or whatever while you're out there.
So on Friday, when I got there, they have, maybe even Thursday, I think, yeah, they have sort of a welcoming just mixer mm-hmm. Thursday night. And people are whispering in my ear, Carrie Ellsworth is here. And so I see her, and I go over to talk to her and to ask if we can do something sometime during the conference. And I go to introduce myself, and she says, I know who you are. Jerry Ellsworth knows who I am. Well, it turns out Jerry's a big fan of all the ham radio shows.
Oh, great.
And it has, at that point, I didn't know, but she has gone head over heels into ham radio, doing all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
So, but at that point, I didn't really know what her interest and involvement was. She had to come out with the magnetic loop that she's built.
Yeah.
Far better than anybody else has built one. I didn't know what level it was going to be, and had no idea that she'd ever seen us.
Yeah, and you know, in your episode, I've listened to her do a couple of other ham radio topic stuff or technical ones, and she's really geeked out, like way more geeky than I ever have been, in a good way. In a good way.
Oh, because she's got the background.
Yeah, absolutely.
She knows how, which is why she wouldn't always be a good fit for this show.
Right.
Because,
yeah,
she'll talk about the social aspects of ham radio a little bit.
Right.
And she's not even a gung-ho feminist. Women in tech. She's some, but that's not her main challenge in life. That's not what she's going for.
Yeah, she's more of a workbench podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah, those guys those guys geek out. All right, we'll move on to, because I see we're over an hour now, and we're just getting to the halfway point. This is, again, another one before my time, episode 152, Friday Night BS number one.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Yep.
I was. This is Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF. Yeah. Bill had gotten into ham radio probably similar time than I did back in the 60s. And by the 70s, he was writing columns for CQ magazine, for 73 magazine. Mm-hmm. He had moved out west and was doing a column called Looking West in 73, and they were getting started doing Newsline back then. And I met him at ARL conference. If you think you've got a video up, you don't.
Oh, you're right.
Once again, looking at your air monitor.
I'm like, oh, let me find a good spot there. I'm like, oh, yes, I'm looking at a great spot, except I'm not looking at you or me.
Yeah. So he was given doing a repeater talk. He was big on repeaters. He was giving a repeater coordination and stuff talk at the ARL Southeastern Division. I think that would be the division. It was in San Diego. And I was running a ham fest in Chicago, and I needed to, it was going to be the week after, and I needed to go out and convince some exhibitors to put their stuff on a truck and haul it out to our ham fest. I was pretty pathetic ham fest coordinator. Mm-hmm. And a couple exhibitors did, and I arranged the truck, and they put their stuff on it. And the next week at our ham fest, they sat in an empty booth because the truck was still 3 days away.
Uh-oh.
They promised that they would arrive on time. That trucking company is still in business. It's called Conway. And I think the con part is appropriate.
Oh, no. That's a shame. Okay, we lost you again. Yeah.
You have gone to black.
Where we go? I pulled this up. There it is. There's Bill.
Okay, so I met Bill at that conference. At that time, I was also frequency coordinator for Northern Illinois. And frequency coordination was, this is the late 1970s. It was fraught, but not as fraught as it got later on. We were beginning to run out of 2 meter channels. There's still plenty of frequencies on 70 centimeters, except in your area, Los Angeles, where people coordinated every frequency possible as soon as coordination existed and claimed to put up remote bases on them. It was every UHF frequency in the repeater directories was called private.
Yeah, it was
in the Los Angeles area.
And used, and they still aren't, but they're all still allocated.
Yeah, and probably no signals at all.
Yeah, a lot of them don't.
So they were trying to figure out the best way to do frequency coordination, and I said, well, here's how I'm doing it in Illinois. I'm not telling you what frequency to use. I'm telling you to go do some survey and tell me what frequency you want to use. I'll be happy to look at the records and see what I know about that and who you might need to contact and work out your own coordination. But you tell me what frequency you're going to use. And Bill thought that was a great idea, and he published that in 73 Magazine, and it went nowhere. Hmm. No one was willing to give up that level of
right. All the coordinators probably
control.
All their coordinators were probably like, "No, thank you, but no thank you." And I'm sure a lot of the folks that wanted the pairs wanted it, but you know, how do they get in control? Because they're not.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there were kind of four episodes in there.
Yeah, Bill appeared on two of them, maybe three of them, and then Bill died.
Yeah.
You can even see on that one that you had the video up on that he was kind of gaunt. He had lost a lot of weight.
Yeah.
He had become, I guess, close to morbidly obese. He had, carrying way too much weight. Mm-hmm. And then
he lost
a variety of ailments. Mm-hmm. So it was a blow to Newsline and to my incipient thought that he would be a great occasional, not exactly co-host, but just a guest because of his long record and long experience and willingness to talk about things that other people are not willing to talk about.
Yeah.
And tell it the way it is. A hallmark of the Ham Radio Now program, rarely heard on other ham radio media.
Yep.
And I got never is heard.
And I got
a discouraging word.
I got one of those episodes coming up.
All right.
Bring Aria back. All right, we'll go on to...
Yeah, speaking of which, she's gotten her acceptance as a... Rhea Jerram is what we're talking about. She's a candidate for...
Official.
The Hudson Division Director.
Yep.
And, yay.
That'll be one of the three or four shows this month. Coming soon. Okay. Coming soon. Okay. Cool. Now, next one is one of my favorites. Ham Radio Now, episode 315... Call CQ. I should have the sound on.
Not going to be anybody.
On repeaters.
To begin with, but let's just make sure.
Where's the video start? It's one of your many. Yes, right. One of your many.
Okay, I have to refresh. I'll do remote technical directing from here.
One of your many Reddit. Yeah, there Reddit.
We are live. And I'm going to stop looking at you, Facebook, because I got to look at other stuff. So if anybody tries to make a comment, I'm going to miss you. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 315. Do not call CQ on repeaters.
I repeat.
That's not too redundant. Do not call CQ on repeaters. And that, by the way, is clickbait. For those of you who wonder what clickbait is, that's clickbait. And you won't believe what happens next.
Okay,
appear to be having fun there.
That is one of the more fun episodes, and I have to stop and go look in my files, because every once in a while I think about this, and I don't think when you sent me all your stuff that came along.
That episode?
No, not the episode. The clickbait.
Oh,
I gotta get that. Although I don't typically do that many clickbaity episodes, that's something I'm missing. Sorry. Go ahead. What were you gonna say?
Yeah, you should do more. I thought I sent it to you, but I have it, so I can certainly send it. It's an external element. It's not a Wirecast thing.
Oh, okay, great. That's just like a video overlay, like the fly-in, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Yeah, I don't think I have that unless I'll email you about that. This was just a fun episode. Even more clickbait.
Here's what this show is all about. Oh, by the way, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Ham Radio Now is brought to you.
And
by
I want to bring this one down to show this one is one of those 12,000 over 12,000 views.
Yep.
This one touched a nerve or at least gained a following.
Yeah, it got enough mentions places that people went and tuned it in.
So that you're a new ham
and all that means to me is that it should have hit 50,000.
I mean, right.
Take any number that you get and quadruple it, and that's what a show should have gotten.
Well, I just wonder, you know, there's only 750,000 hams out there, so what's that right penetration? Is it 10%? So it should have been 75,000 views.
And nobody knows how many active hams there are. Everybody uses a conventional wisdom rule of thumb of, you know, maybe half or at least, you know, moderately active once a month or so.
Right.
So that knocks it down to, in the U.S., a few hundred thousand.
Right. So 300,000.
If it was 10% of that, it'd be about 30,000.
Yeah.
That might not be too bad.
Yeah. So some of these get in that vicinity, into that territory. But this was just a fun. This was a fun episode, and I don't think this is one. I don't think I was there for this one.
Notorious.
No, this is a solo show.
This is one you just shut off. I don't know if it was one that you had been cooking on or
not very long.
Yeah, and you did. And I'm pretty sure by 3:15 I was around.
Yeah, I think you were in some of the shows up and around that territory.
Oh, that was probably when we were doing MCOM extras.
Well, so it was April 2017, and you started a thought sometime in like November or so.
Yeah. Oh, this may have been in the in between, after you put out the call and before I joined in. But anyhow,
so many shows.
This is a good one. If you haven't watched this one, definitely that's one worth pulling up. And I will do.
And
my
people
best.
Misunderstood like crazy. They thought the title was literal. And they were saying, why not call CQ? I said, well, if you watch the show, you'll find that telling you calling CQ on repeaters is perfectly legitimate.
Right.
But you know, most people who complain have never watched the show they're complaining about.
Right.
Complaining about the headline.
And you know, the reality is, as long as you're not singing, do whatever you want on the repeater. Or don't call break, 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 unless it's something really important.
I talk about that in there, I think.
I think you did. But that's a good
one. I'm not an advocate of the word break in any form.
Now, this next episode, this one hit the numbers.
It did.
This one did. 45.
Which means it should have been at 100,000.
45, almost 46,000 system confusion. And you know what? I think you still get flack about this one. People are annoyed you call it system confusion.
Yeah.
I love it. I think it's great.
Once again, it's the title is more controversial than anything in the episode. And it didn't even push clickbait because I wanted to play it here just to see
is this one clickbait? Because this is total clickbait.
Wait a second.
And you even did up a lower third for this.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I probably spent an hour on
Photoshop in this one.
Photoshop building that out of their actual logo and you know, cutting and pasting.
That's great.
And that title, that name, System Confusion, that caught on. I don't know if
it did.
If it totally began from this, or if it was just logical enough, because it's sort of a no-brainer.
Yeah, yeah, it's easy, and I hear that all the time. Well, they talk about it on. Some of the meetings I go to, and I know like some of the people know I do the show, but I don't think hardly anybody watches it. But you get out there and you got D-Star versus the FTD1 radio, and now Yeshu's, they've expanded the line. I have two System Fusion radios, and I don't ever use it. It's about the same size.
The ICOM
it's not taken off,
taller, but the Yeshu's got a full keyboard.
But, you know, it's
I don't know how much Fusion there is in use around there. There's nothing in my area.
Oh, there's some here. There are a number of repeaters that are.
Well, you're in Los Angeles.
Yeah, we're in
David.
Los Angeles. Yes. But you know, the thing is, the guys that I talk to on the radio, they're not using they're using Yaesu radios, but they're not using the Fusion radios. You know, it's all older ones, and it's another repeaters that we use. So we're not doing it.
There's a Fusion repeater in Charlotte. I'm not sure how many there are elsewhere around the state. I think they're putting one up in the Greensboro area. This area that I live in, this Research Triangle Park, this high tech area, has one D-Star repeater that does not have internet on it, and no Fusion repeaters, and a few DMR repeaters around the area. But the main one also doesn't have internet, so it doesn't get much use. So we are in a digital wasteland. Mm-hmm. Here.
Gotta
so
fix
my
that.
D-Star stuff gets very little use.
It's gotta fix that. But that's not your windmill to tilt at, right?
That's what I wanted to do. I would do it, but yeah. I'm not the tower guy. I don't know the access to all those places. Other guys do.
Got it.
And I'm not that good at it. I can plug and play, but
Right.
You know, I'll break repeaters faster than I can build them.
Well, I'm hoping to bring back a System Confusion episode soon, because I do have those radios, and I know there's a repeater I can hit. I want to do a little more technical show on what could you really do with it, and I might clickbait it System Confusion part two. Who knows? We'll see.
Maybe I've got that graphic I can send you. I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. I'll mock it up myself. So the next one, let's see if I can get this right. Oh, there you go. These are some of my favorite episodes.
It's 500 miles to Dayton
on the road.
It was dark when
and
I started.
You said all of them, but this is the one that you linked.
And
I think this was the one where you went through the stack.
Episode, I'm not sure.
No, this is one where you got right on the road. That's a different one.
The Dayton 500. Hit it.
Well, that's right. This one you just get out on the
road.
On the road.
Wearing that headset.
It was episode 300. That was a multi-part episode, and I showed off the Q-mobile.
Right.
In part one, was all in my driveway.
You're RAV4, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
As I turn my head, you can hear a little.
Which may be for sale sometime.
You're going to strip all the equipment out of it first? Or you're going to sell it as it is?
Don't know. And I'm not for sure going to sell it. Cindy's getting a new car. Uh-huh. It would be smart for me to buy her car, which is a few years newer and many thousands of miles newer. The RAV4 is a 2007, so it's 11 years old, and it's got almost 80,000 miles on it. Still running fine.
Yeah. That's my FJ is a 07. I have 191,000, and the same thing. It's running good. I won't ever get rid of that thing.
Yeah. So as a car, its Blue Book value is around $3,000, $4,000. If I were to sell it with all the equipment in it, it would have to be $13,000 or $14,000.
Yeah,
I don't know if anybody's going to do that.
Yeah, I don't think anybody will buy it for that. But these are just great episodes. Is this you driving down the road and talking to folks? And I know every once in a while we do these episodes where people will get in there and comment, you know, you shouldn't be talking on the radio and you shouldn't be showing this to the public, and they're going to think their hands-free laws are more important. And yeah.
Tune in again in a little bit and see if.
We don't have any history of hams getting into traffic accidents because they're talking on the ham radio.
Right.
In this case, I believe it's an issue of we're just too small. That stuff is not going to hit news. It's probably happened, but there are not even any anecdotes out there.
Where's your antenna?
Google 5 Nexus phone.
That was a little DV dongle.
Yep.
DVAP dongle. And if I had an antenna on it, it would overload.
Okay.
And everybody would tell me that they couldn't hear me. I'd be breaking up. I took the antenna off.
Got it.
I could still hear it fine. And my signal into it evidently wasn't overloading it. It was the first generation. I don't think they got that problem anymore.
So the guy behind you can also get out in the.
And that's quite a stack. You still work the air conditioning from there, can't you?
Yeah. Yeah, the air conditioning comes around it. And it keeps the radios cool.
Right.
And put the hot sun pouring on them. Mm-hmm. So here I could hear myself in the background. I'm doing a traffic know, how to drive
right.
tutorial. Here, I don't know about where you are when, well, first of all, we are loaded with left turn lights, you know, left arrows.
Mm-hmm.
We've even got something with a blinking yellow left turn arrow.
Burbank has those.
Yeah, which confuses the hell out of me because it's the same thing as just a plain old green light.
Right.
But most intersections have a protected left arrow. Uh-huh. And that intersection did, but it was one where the left arrow just went off, and you ended up with pure green, not a red left arrow. And so that just meant you can turn left when it's clear.
Right.
And we don't have that many intersections that have just a pure straight ahead green light and no left turn indication. So at those few intersections that we do, people will sit at the line.
Oh, yeah, and they don't know that they can go.
Yeah, and they won't go until the next light cycle.
Yeah, yeah.
And they don't get out, and if they don't get out into the intersection, maybe they can go, but the person behind them can't.
Right.
And I remember a talk show guy on KOA in Denver. When I was in 1986, I took a year-long or a summer-long motorcycle trip across the country, and for the whole western side of it, in the night, I would listen to a talk show guy at a KOA in Denver, 50,000 watt, clear channel station, and he would rant every now and then about what you do when you're in the left turn lane and the light is green and there's traffic coming on. Two cars get in the intersection, and then when the light turns yellow, those two cars can go through, and the one guy left at the line also goes through. Three cars go through on the yellow. Three. Denver evidently had a lot of bad left turn traffic. Bad, three cars go drivers. Through on the yellow.
Yeah.
I remember that. Here in North Carolina, nobody goes through on the yellow. We all just sit.
You just sit and wait.
And nobody goes out in the intersection except me. And people look at me like, what is that guy doing?
What's wrong with you?
People tell me it's illegal to go out there.
Yeah, I don't think so. Well, you're on the HF there. How many radios are in that car? And your laptop?
Five,
okay.
Eight antennas, five radios, I think. And at that point, there were six. Because uh-huh. there the Kenwood... D710 was down out of sight.
Gotcha.
And that scanner that's sitting there has been replaced by a DMR. Don't use the scanner anymore.
Mm-hmm. People love these episodes. I love these episodes too. It's just fun to see. You know, and you know, you think about it, it's like, okay, well, I'm going to get in my car and drive around and talk on the radio. How exciting is that?
Yep.
But it is, you know.
I people from Europe especially liked them because they just, you know, they're seeing America through a windshield.
Right, exactly. When I did my Baker to Vegas, mostly I did the other direction, but I had some of the dash cam in there as well. You know, you could see me sitting and driving and the kids poking their head in. And I got some okay feedback. I also got people saying, you know, you shouldn't be showing people that we can talk on the radio because they're going to want to talk on the radio too. Okay. Sorry to burst your bubble. And there are a lot of these on the air episodes, and again, those are ones that you can go back. So we've made it and all.
So
the way.
I've made up a playlist on the YouTube channel that collected those because they were hard to find.
Oh, right.
So now there's a playlist; you can get them all.
And is that's in the Ham Radio Now group, right?
YouTube.com/HamRadioNow.
Got it. And now, for the number one episode.
Number 1111. No one's going to guess.
Nobody is going to guess. I actually thought it was a different one. Okay, first of all, who am I talking to? AMSAT. This was episode 2.
Yeah, fade that up again and let it start over again.
Okay, wait a second. Episode 2, part 2. This is like something of 4?
Of 12.
Of 12, okay. Who am I talking to? This is
Lou McFadden, W5DID. Lou McFadden, now wait a minute. I've heard that name. I've heard that call sign. You're involved in satellites or something.
Yeah. I've been working on amateur radio satellites and amateur radio in space since 1980.
Since there was space.
Yeah.
Well, maybe since there was hams in space.
Since there were hams in space, yeah.
All right. What are we standing in front of?
This is the Arisat 1 backup unit here. We built, when we built Arisat 1, we built four units. This is number two. Number one is the one that flew.
There may be some people out there, I'm not sure, there may be some people out there who don't know even what Arisat 1 is. So let's take a step back and explain what that is.
Arisat 1 started with the
Okay,
with the
you can
original
pull
plan.
That down.
So, okay,
and,
wait a minute. So
anybody can go look at the episode if they want.
So that big thing is floating around in space?
No, that thing burnt. That was pushed out of the space station.
Got it.
One of the things we'll talk about in that episode is that anything that they push out of the space station is, by definition, going to be in a decelerating orbit.
So at some point, it'll fall into the
Yeah, and the joke I made was that you don't want it coming around and hitting the space station again.
Right. You think?
So Lou is just a legend in satellites.
I blew it.
Go ahead. So Lou,
we should explain to people that running all this equipment,
this stuff is hard.
Doing all this stuff and being on the show is very hard.
It's hard. Get this stuff right.
I'm wearing shorts. I'm not standing here sitting here with no clothes on.
No, we just got an explicit rating.
We did not.
Gary did a show, and
I have. I'm doing it in network anchor style, you know, where I've got a suit on top and shorts underneath,
shorts and some tennis shoes.
Yeah. So Lou is a legend in space, and the reason I made that number one is that was the first Ham Radio Now series that I did. I gave an honorable mention to episode one. Episode one is a tour of the Orlando Hamcation. But I went down there in 2012. I was just being exited from Ham Nation at that time, sort of realizing that they weren't calling me anymore to do fill-in. There had been many shows by that point that Bob had not been on. And they were having George and Gordon and, at that point, Don do the shows, and they weren't calling me.
Yeah.
And I kind of got the message. But they were still willing to bring me back. I told them I would give them a wrap-up of Orlando, and they said that would be fine. And so I edited a little tour, short tour for them to play, and a longer tour for me to play. And then I did maybe a dozen interviews, anywhere from 15 minutes or so to close to an hour. The long one was with Rich Moseson, the CQ editor, W2VU, and no one had heard of the show before. I had some claim to fame and credibility among some people. I mean, Rich certainly knew who I was. Lou McFadden had no idea what he was in the middle of, but I had just been so tickled every time when I did that, when I edited it, with the way he gave me sort of license to do what I do, and reacted in a somewhat befuddled, I don't quite understand what's going on here, but I'll go with it. And, and then somewhat straight ahead. Well, they put the side panels on that satellite with Velcro. And so I'm saying, well, you don't build the real satellite with Velcro. That's just for the demonstration. Nope. The real satellite
is Velcro.
It's Velcro. Wow. The panels are on with Velcro. So I'm just always tickled with how that went. I'm happy with my performance. And remember, at this point in Ham Radio Now and in my career, I had disc jockeyed a little bit. I had done maybe two or three interviews on the radio a decade or 15 years before that. I'd done a couple of interviews as a sort of a last minute field producer for some big shows, for Inside Edition and for America's Most Wanted. They hired the TV company I was working for to go shoot some stuff that was happening in North Carolina. And they put me in the position of being the field producer, which meant I conducted the interviews. most of which, you know, my side never got on the air. It was just the person I was talking to. But one quick blip did get on because of the way I asked a question. They couldn't really edit it out. And so I had very little experience with doing this. And I'm just tickled with the way it all worked out, with both Lou as a guest and me as the, you know, doing this. And the other interviews in among everything that is episode two of Ham Radio Now were all in that same weekend in the same kind of situation. Give a shout out to Cliff Broughton, W4FT. He was my cameraman down there. Oh, the other thing about that is I had a hernia and I could barely walk. So Cliff had to carry all the equipment, and anytime you saw me standing up for more than a few minutes, the pain was building up.
And you were looking for ice packs when you were done.
I didn't really do that, but yeah, it was. Yeah. I should have been. So I'm putting that one as my number one. It's always been my favorite.
You know, so when you sent the list, I thought, oh, you know, I got to build my own top 10 list, and I didn't really have the time. I went through a couple, but I have a couple. I have two. I actually thought when I first got the list, the number one, let's see if I can make this work right. I thought that's you.
Oh, did it wrong.
I thought this was going to be the number one because I love this episode.
Ham Radio Now, episode 283, A Ham's Night Before Christmas, the live edition.
I just thought this was great. Got all dressed up. You got Arvin's tinsel. The Roman gnome's got a hat on. And this one, I think this is the one that you have with, this is not the one with the video over it. Oh yeah. But you went back and played
HT's the, you know, the little, day they'd be extras.
Is this video that's underneath? This is from the original one you did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The original high def one.
The high def one.
The very original one was standard def that far back.
And is this a different episode? Is that one? I can't remember exactly. That one with the high def that's a separate episode.
The standard def is not a Ham Radio Now episode. Uh-huh.
The high def one is.
I did a high def version as a Ham Radio Now episode, one of the early ones.
Got it.
And the standard def is still out there. It's on the, I think, youtube.com, either /KN4AQ or KN4AQ2. Mm-hmm. I forget which one.
But that was definitely one. And then, of course...
And it is still the one that's got the most views. It was up in the 75, 80,000 range.
Yeah, this one only 756, but the other one, yeah, like you said, that one had traction. We'll bring that one back. And then, of course,
I gave that an honorable mention. It's within the top 30. Yeah,
it was the last one on your honorable mention list. And there were a lot of other honorable mentions. And of course, your second honorable mention was... this one, and this would have been my first episode.
Hello, Facebook Live. This is
my first non-bowl episode.
Episode 270, the very first MCOM extra. I've been threatening to do this for some time, and Hurricane Matthew is on the way. Got a picture of that. Yeah, that's what it sort of looks like right now. It's just about to start beating heavily into Florida as we record this. And I couldn't get anybody from the Florida section, from the Georgia section, from the South Carolina section. I couldn't get any of those ARL guys to talk to me. I'm changing glasses to get rid of the reflections here. They're all too busy with the hurricane. So I picked up a couple of other useless characters here.
And this is before the studio. I think this was one of the first ones. I think we did a bull session. Marty and you and I did a bull session or two. But this was before I got kicked out of the office. So that's the office in the background there.
And whatever happened to Marty?
Yeah, Marty's... Well, I think Marty's been away.
He recorded a bunch of episodes for his show at Dayton and never released any.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't think he's been away at camp. Like when we tried to do this 400 show earlier... he was way at camp and he said he could get a quiet room or quiet space or whatever. Cause he was working at summer camp all summer.
Yeah, it may have gotten in the way.
Yeah. It may have gotten in the way. And who knows?
He's also, you know, he's a kid. His interests will flit from one area to another.
Yep. Yep. Well, this has been great. We did the top 10.
Yeah. It's been a good run.
Yeah.
And I am counting on you to carry it on.
Yep. I need to get on my game. I'm, like I said, I'm trying to do two or three good episodes a month. I know that everybody out there would probably like to see 4 or 5, but I just, the times it's hard. I got job and kids, and my wife who just stuck her head in here a little while ago and other stuff.
I saw you paying attention to someone out there.
What's going on? And
also, I should have mentioned this at the top of the show. One of the other things that I've done, we saw it with Jerry with the Tapper conference, is that I would shoot the Tapper conference every year.
Yeah.
And I was planning on doing that this year, and wasn't enthusiastic about it. I was going to run a really expensive Kickstarter that I didn't expect would make it. And Jason Johnston, KC5HWB, who does the Ham Radio 2.0 show, asked me if, since he saw I was leaving this, what I was going to do about Tapper. And he didn't want to horn in on the territory, but if I was interested, he would be doing it. He would be glad to do it. And so we talked to Steve Bible, who's the Tapper president, and everything looked good. And so he is going to do it. He's got a Kickstarter running, and I don't know.
Share that up there.
Yeah, I don't even have a browser open here.
Here, I think I can. Do
I'm kind of curious because I haven't looked in a while to see how well his Kickstarter is going. Let's see.
Let's see. Where is it on the page? I've got the page up here. Kickstarter.
Oh, okay. You're getting into it faster than me.
Let's see, but I don't know. Oh, here goes. Kickstarter campaign.
Okay, so he's up at $1,200.
Oh, he's more than
and it's a $2,100, so he's more than halfway, yeah. And he's got halfway to go. So I really wish I had mentioned this at the beginning of the show while we still had an audience. he's doing a much more modest Kickstarter. If I'd have done it, it's going to be in Albuquerque, which would be a long trip for me.
It's closer for him.
Yeah, it's a 1-day drive for him and a 3-day drive, three long day drive for me.
Right.
And I don't have a flying package. I can't put all my equipment in an airplane. Mm-hmm. So I would have had a Kickstarter for $8,000.
Yeah,
he's doing it for $2,100. So
well, and I hope he
won't be as technically adept. I would do it with 4 cameras. I think he'll be doing it with 3. Mm-hmm. And I've seen the stuff he has done at Hamfest forums. He's done a bunch of Hamfest forums, and my technique is more refined. There's no question, but he will get it on the air. Mm-hmm. And if he keeps doing this, his technique will come up and match and exceed what I've been able to do. Mm-hmm. So if you're at all interested in the Tapper stuff, that's another bitter disappointment in life. The Tapper stuff is at the cutting edge of everything in ham radio. Every episode that comes out of someone doing a talk from there deserves thousands of people, and some of them deserve tens of thousands of people. And instead they get hundreds of people or a couple of thousands of people. And there's something wrong with that.
Well, and I think I know from having taken over the show, a lot of the support that you got for Ham Radio Now came out of those folks, because the Patreon's dwindling because we're not doing the Tapper stuff. I can't cover the Tapper stuff. There's no way.
Yeah.
Someday, it might be interesting and I have more time, but that's not on my plate right now. And it's what it is.
Well, it's, it takes a lot of hardware.
Yep.
I whittled it down to the point where I could do it with one person. Right. When I did the first few, I had me and 2 other people running camera. Mm-hmm. And that was not sustainable. Jeff went out to a couple of them with me, and Cliff went out to a couple of them with me. But that was hard to keep on going. I figured out how to do it with just one person, which is also a little dangerous because if that one person gets sick,
right,
then nothing happens.
And you got to roll all the cameras and then go back and do a lot of editing and making sure that everything worked. You know, I did the stuff I did at Tucson. I got some good feedback and I got some good views, especially the Dick Norris forum. But it was one camera and it was hard. And you know, I had challenges. Luckily, the challenges I had were here with the Wirecast and not in the camera. With the loopback stuff, but like you said, it's not easy.
And you got that fixed.
I did. Yeah, I republished the episode in a day or two once I figured out what I was doing wrong.
Yeah, Wirecast has some hidden landmines that can get you, and you can't tell if you're not. There's some things you can do to sort of prepare yourself for it, but mostly it's just a lot of background work before you launch an episode. And
yeah,
there's that always going to be that one little thing you didn't check and that goes wrong.
Well, and I've learned I have to sit down here and record 5 minutes before I do anything, after I've made changes for anything at all, and then play it back on a totally separate PC to make sure it looks okay and good and gets loaded up.
Yeah.
Okay, we're getting to 2 hours, and I know my wife stuck my head in, and I got to go and check and see if all is good in the house. I don't smell any fire, but you never know.
Cindy's waiting for me for dinner.
Excellent. So this was Ham Radio Now, episode number 400, Ham Radio Now, the most important.
Oh, you fixed the title.
On the internet. Yeah, I'm learning stuff. I am learning stuff.
On the fly, you fixed the title.
Absolutely. If you like what I'm doing and want to support me, please visit hamradionow.tv, look for Arvin and click the pig, and you can send us money via Patreon, PayPal, or my address is on there. You can put some green stuff in an envelope and send it to me. Thank you very much for getting this far, and thank you, Gary, for coming back and joining me. I'm hoping every once in a while I'll be able to entice you to come and share your knowledge and other ham radio stuff with us.
Well, I'm not totally off of ham radio. In fact, there's one quick story that I'll relate just to wrap things up. As I was driving back from visiting my stepmom, which is about a 90-minute drive, so I had the antenna on the car and the Q-mobile, and I was tuning around 20 meters. You know, we're in kind of the doldrums of the sunspot cycle. And I heard this guy on 20 meters at a pretty good signal, and he was talking about podcasts and stuff, and it turned out to be Bert, K1OIK. Does that call or name
it does sound
ring
familiar.
A bell with you?
It does sound familiar.
Yeah, Bert's done some YouTube stuff. He's got one of the highest view ham radio YouTube videos out there. It's in the 125,000 view. I think it's called What's Wrong with Ham Radio, so sort of get an idea. Uh-huh. Bert could be relied on, and he'll probably show up in the YouTube comments or somewhere. I don't know if you announce things on QRZ.com anymore. You should, if you don't.
Yeah, the last episodes haven't been as newsy and more chatty.
Doesn't matter.
Okay, well, I'll get them.
Doesn't
up
matter.
We'll get them up.
I talked to Fred, the QRZ.com guru, on the show in Orlando. And I said, I felt bad getting on the main news thing and announcing the shows because it kind of clogs them up. And he also has a second forum just for shows. And he said, no, there's a level of shows that belong in the main news.
Right. The production value of this.
Ham Nation, Ham Radio Now, a couple of the others belong in the main news. Okay. And a guy that's just showing off his handy talkie on YouTube, that goes in the YouTube or the videos and blogs for him. So you got permission from the big guy.
Cool. Well, we'll get there.
Yep. So so Bert, K1OIK, I gave him a call. Oh, his comments, he was a broken record. His comments were always, the shows are too long, you should edit things. Mm-hmm. This may sound familiar. Mm-hmm. You're skillful, you know how to do this stuff, why don't you edit? If I had to discipline one of my students, I guess he's a teacher, he would make them watch the show. Nice. So there he was. Uh-huh. And I called him. K1OIK, this is Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec, Mobile in North Carolina. KN4AQ, K1OIK, name here is Bert, location is on Cape Cod. Bert, Kilo November 4. Alpha, Quebec. Yeah, well, man, I got your call sign. Got it fine. You're not real strong, but copy okay. Bert, Kilo, November 4.
If you do it that way,
Alpha,
that way, he's not going to get it.
Quebec. My name is Gary. Over.
Do you get it then?
Okay, Gary. Yeah. Copy. I'm up here in Long Island. Bert, you should know who I am. I'm pretty old. You know, it's not ringing a bell. Okay, Bert, I also do a show, the best amateur radio program on the internet. Oh, hi, Gary. Now I recognize who you are.
Very
and cool. Then he proceeded to recommend that I
you edit and
make shows a lot shorter. And, 10 minutes is long as it should be. This one's for you, Bert. You kicked me off the air.
Hopefully, Bert, you'll get to the end, or at least you'll have one of your students watch us to the end.
Yeah, if you're punishing a student, if you're a student of Bert's, yep, and you're being punished and required to watch the show all the way to the end, tell him we finally talked about him.
And tell him thank you.
That the hour and 45 minute mark.
That's right. All right, shall we close? You want to do the first part or the bottom part?
I'll do the first part because I always do the bottom part before. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Oh, wait. Do that one more time.
I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Host emeritus.
Yes, you are.
And founder of Ham Radio Now.
Oh, I'll change that. I'll get that in there. And I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG, current editor, host, producer, and bottle washer at Ham Radio Now.
Over.
And out.
Boom.
When that worked.
That worked.
About half the time it doesn't.
And now, the best part of the show.
I wish I could do the best part of the show, but I think if I don't stick my head inside, I'm going to be in trouble. Thank you. Thank you much, Gary. We'll talk soon.
Okay. See
you. Say hi to Cindy.